So a new study just came out looking at intermittent fasting, and it's been making waves. The New York Times even wrote a piece on it. Over 100 people were randomized. Half were told to eat 3 meals, no time restriction. The other half were the intermittent fasting group. They were told to only eat in an 8-hour window, from noon to 8 p.m. So this is one of the most common protocols for intermittent fasting. We covered it in a previous video. It's called 16-8. You eat for 8 hours and fast for 16. It's also called time-restricted eating. So what did they find? After 3 months, there was no significant difference in weight loss between intermittent fasting and the controls. Both groups lost a very small amount. The people on intermittent fasting lost less than 1 kilo, which is about 2 pounds, which is not a lot for 3 months. This was surprising because some previous studies have shown weight loss with intermittent fasting in this 16-8 pattern. Also, that weight they lost seems it was mostly lean mass, not fat. Other biomarkers like cholesterol, glucose, etc. weren't improved on intermittent fasting either, which is expected because those tend to track with weight loss. So what does this mean? Does it mean intermittent fasting doesn't work? No. It means it didn't work in these specific conditions. That's always the question. How was the experiment done? For example, when we look at the data person by person, we see big variation. Some people lost quite a bit of weight, others didn't. Some even gained weight. This is not surprising when we look at the details of how the trial was done. You always have this trade-off in science. You can do your experiment in really controlled conditions in a lab setting, or you can do them in more realistic conditions where you lose some of the control and some of the rigor, but on the other hand, you find out what happens in the real world. One approach is not better than the other, they just address slightly different questions. So here they took that real world approach. People were instructed to eat within the 8-hour time window and were left to decide everything else. On one hand, that's an interesting question to ask. We know most people are going to decide to try intermittent fasting because they heard about it on TV or they saw it on a magazine cover. They're not going to be too strict. They're not going to measure 1,000 parameters. They're not going to keep track of much. So this is a good reflection. On the other hand, this approach leaves a ton of loose strings. They told people when to eat, but not what to eat, and they didn't measure calorie intake. They made some calculations and estimated there was probably no difference between the groups. So we could say, well, of course, if there's no difference in caloric intake, of course, they're not going to lose more weight. But the fact is, some previous studies showed weight loss on intermittent fasting, even in isocaloric conditions. But we didn't see that here. We could also complain, well, what's the point of a weight loss study that doesn't measure calorie intake? And that's an understandable grievance. But the whole claim to fame of intermittent fasting is that all you gotta do is eat within this time window, the simplicity, right? Forget the calories, forget the carbs. As long as you eat within this time window, you lose weight. Here's one of the researchers who studies intermittent fasting. The best part is there are no limitations during the eating window, she said. There's no carb or calorie counting, and people don't have to switch out all the food in their pantries. So there is this idea, even among some scientists, and certainly among the public, that as long as you eat during that time window, you lose weight. And this study is telling us it's not quite that simple. People are being told fasting delivers all these wonderful effects. It detoxes you, it allows your gut to rest, whatever else. But the actual evidence indicates it's not about the fasting. Even in the studies that show results, it's often about calorie balance. Other times, it seems to be about chronobiology, what time you eat, not fasting per se. We covered all of this in detail in the time-restricted eating video. People are being told autophagy works wonders, based on extrapolations from mouse studies. So intermittent fasting can work for some people in some settings, not others. That's fine. But the hype around it is ridiculous. Now, if we want to refine the message and tell people, use this time window not because it's magical, but because it helps you control how much you eat. And you also have to be mindful of overall caloric intake and also make sure you eat high quality foods. I'm 100% behind that. But that's not the message most people are getting. What sells like hotcakes is the simplicity. That's why this spread like wildfire. If they tell people, use this time window, but by the way, you also need to cut calories, most people are just gonna go, well, thanks. Another aspect some people have complained about is the duration. That 3 months is too short, and maybe if they went longer, they would see better results. Always a possibility. So here's 6 rapid-fire takeaways from the study, what we learned, and what you can do if you're interested in intermittent fasting. Number 1, just saying that I'm gonna do intermittent fasting does not necessarily mean I'm gonna lose extra fat. That may require caloric balance, or it may require a specific timing. And that's takeaway number two. Some previous trials point to an earlier time window, front-loading your meals, having a big breakfast, and then a light or no dinner, what they call early time-restricted eating, instead of skipping breakfast, which is what they did in this trial. Some studies even indicate that shifting your meals later, like they did here, can harm you metabolically. Now, this isn't crystal clear. There's some uncertainty, some studies that don't perfectly align, some loose ends. This field is very new, and there's a lot that hasn't been figured out yet. But given the totality of the evidence we have right now, if I was going to try intermittent fasting, I would probably lean towards that earlier time window, as long as it fits into my lifestyle pattern. Takeaway number three, individual variation. The best diet for you is the one you can stick with. So if intermittent fasting works for you, if you're losing some extra fat, phenomenal. If not, there are other tools to achieve the same goals. Four, losing weight is not the same as losing fat. So be careful with that excessive focus on the scale, the tyranny of the scale, and the obsession with the numbers. In the study, there was a loss of lean mass. Now, losing some lean mass, including some muscle, is normal during weight loss. The way to minimize that is to include some resistance training and to make sure you have adequate protein intake. Number five, losing some extra fat is a good thing, but not at any cost. If you lose fat and you harm your health in the process, it beats the purpose. So make sure whatever fat loss approach you choose, you're still focusing on high quality foods. Number six, beware the hype with any new trends. The hype train runs way ahead of the science. Sometimes it's just a waste of time and money. Other times it's dangerous. Always ask for the evidence. And if all they can show you is a mouse study or some anecdotes or some speculation based on physiology, be suspicious. Like I've said before, I have no problem with intermittent fasting per se. I'm not anti-IF. I'm anti-BS. If we can separate solid scientific information from marketing, we can make educated decisions and protect ourselves. Here's the previous video on intermittent fasting, and here's one where we focused specifically on time-restricted eating with all the details. Check them out. I'll see you next week.